Yes, guys. So now let's answer the question about corporate debt restructuring. My question comes across really, really simple manner, man. When I adopt as an enterprise a CDR with a bank, I've gone into a CDR process with the bank. My question is very simple. I'm asking, have I extinguished the previous liability and have undertaken a new liability, or is it that the earlier liability was just modified? Question very simple. I said, I've gone into a CDR process. What is a CDR process? CDR process basically restructures all your cash flows. Restructures your cash flows of existing financial liability of enterprise. I've restructured, fine. My question is, at the time of restructuring, should I say, at the time when I've restructured the existing cash flows, should I say that it is a modified contract? Modified financial liability, is this the question? Or the existing financial liability is extinguished? I have to answer this question now. To answer this question, you have something called as 10% window. Now, what is this 10% window that we are talking about? Let's see. I will compare two items, A and B. What is this A and B which I'm trying to compare? I'm saying A is the present value of cash flows arising subsequent to restructuring. Obviously, I'm using a EIR to discount it. Present value of cash flows arising subsequent to the restructuring of the contract, compared with A, the present value of remaining liability existing prior to restructuring. Prior to restructuring. Again using my EIR. On comparison between A and B, if I say this is greater than or equal to 10% of B, if the difference between A and B is greater than or equal to 10% of B, in such situation where it is greater than or equal to 10% of B, I'm saying, if your answer is yes, then I would say that the existing financial liability is extinguished and a new financial liability is assumed. But if your answer is no, then I cannot say that the existing financial liability is extinguished, I'll only say that the existing financial liability is modified. The existing financial liability is modified. Now that means this case I will derecognize it. Here I will not apply the derecognition provisions at all. So I'm saying here I'll apply derecognition criteria or accounting treatment. Here it is no derecognition which is applicable. Now this is probably the criteria which I'm talking about whenever I'm looking at the process of corporate debt restructuring. I said I will compare the present value of cash flows arising after the CDR process compared with present value of cash flows existing liability before the CDR process. If your difference is more than or equal to 10% of the cash flows, present value of cash flows prior to the CDR process, then I will say that there is a derecognition of financial liability. Now guys, this derecognition process does not happen free of cost. There is certain amount of cost which I incur in a CDR process. Now what about the expenses? Expenses which are incurred incidental to CDR process. My expenditure incurred incidental to CDR process, when I assume that financial liability is extinguished, what is the treatment? When you say that the financial liability is modified and not extinguished, then what is the treatment? When your financial liability is extinguished, in such situation, the expenses incurred should be simply charged to P&L. But when my financial liability is modified, in such cases, adjust to the value of amortized cost. So I'm doing a recalculation of amortized cost. Recomputation of amortized cost is necessary so that we accommodate for those expenses which are included now under your amount of amortized cost of existing financial liability. These are the two significant accounting treatments that arise whenever we have expenditure incurred in a CDR process. Got it? So this will end our concept regarding CDR recognition, derecognition of all your financial assets and liabilities. Certain more ITFGs to be coming up before we discuss about hedge accounting. Very interesting concept is hedge accounting, which is going to arise. But this CDR process, please remember, because there's a very practical in today's world, majority of the situations have been evidencing a CDR process with the bankers. Yes, guys. So let's start discussion on financial assets to begin with. What is a financial asset? How do I classify an item as a financial asset? For us to find or call an item as a financial asset, it includes, number one, cash. I'll discuss further into it. Let me complete this definition. Or a contractual right. To receive cash. Or another financial asset. Contractual right to receive cash or to receive another financial asset. Number three. Contract for exchange of financial assets and liabilities. Under conditions potentially favorable to the enterprise. Contract for exchange of financial assets and financial liabilities. Under contracts which are potentially favorable, under conditions which are potentially favorable to the enterprise. This term is really important. And finally, contracts to receive entities own equity instrument . This is my understanding of financial asset. What exactly did I put across here, and how do we identify and signify each item? The first one that I'm looking at is the word cash. Here, cash includes either my cash in hand or at bank, whatever it is. At bank also no problem, because such cash you can draw and you can use at your own will and wish. Contractual right to receive cash. I'm talking about right to receive cash. Now, right to receive cash, for me to explain, look at your trade receivables. Your trade receivables are amounts which are contractual right to receive cash. Because let's say I have sold goods to Mr. X on credit basis, and Mr. X had to pay me 100 rupees and he said he'll pay after 30 days of credit. That means X is shown as a debtor in my books for those 100 rupees. Such amount, there is a contractual right to collect cash from Mr. X. Also, I'm talking about advances. I'm also talking about advances given. But provided such advances which are refundable. Now, there are certain advances, you can call them as deposits also, which might not be refunded. For example, if I look at, let's say I'm giving an advance to my staff, a staff advance. What happens? Next time, whenever I have to pay his salary, I will take back the amount which is paid already as an advance to him. So this we can call them as refundable advance. Let's say I have paid an advance to a supplier. Now, whenever I've given an advance to the supplier, is the supplier going to give me back the cash? Absolutely no. He is going to make sure that he's providing goods for to that extent. So that is why I'm saying advances which are refundable or deposits which are refundable can be called as contractual right to receive cash. Now, what is this contractual right to receive another financial asset? That means I'm talking about those items which are settled other than cash, but should be settled in a financial asset. For example, instead of delivering cash, he has given me a bill receivable. So here I can put across endorsement of bill. I have received a bill instead of receiving cash. Even in such situation, you will say that it is a contractual right to receive another financial asset. Now, contractual for exchange of financial assets and financial liabilities in a manner which is potentially favorable to the enterprise. Now, these contracts, you can talk about derivative contracts. With favorable conditions. For example, let's say I have entered into a futures contract to buy dollar at 65 rupees. Today, the prevailing market rate of dollar is 67. I would definitely exercise my option. I would definitely make sure that the future is traded and I buy the dollar at 65 because the current market price is 67, I gain 2 rupees. It's a potentially favorable situation for me. But the person who has written that contract, for him, it is a loss. It is an unfavorable situation. So whenever it is favorable to my entity, it is unfavorable to the other entity as well. Look at options. Option, when I look at, I have an option to buy a particular share of Infosys, if it is priced below 1500. Today I find that the price of the share is already 1650. Favorable condition. Because I've entered into an option to buy the share of Infosys in a favorable condition only. In such situation, you call them as financial assets. Contracts to receive entity's own equity instrument, I'll divide them into two parts. One is net settled in cash. And second one is physical delivery of shares. When an item is net settled in cash, a contract to exchange his own shares, this is covered as per the standard. Physical delivery of shares, I'm not gonna cover it as per the standard because it amounts to buyback. Contract to receive entity's own equity instruments. I'm receiving entity's own equity instrument. That means I've entered into a contract to receive my own shares. If I'm doing a net settlement in cash, let's say Mr. X has actually, I've signed a contract with Mr. X saying that this contract will be settled on a particular date based on the current market price of my own share. And I said, you will have to pay me the shares or give me the shares at a value of 1500 rupees. Today I find that the price of my share has already gone beyond 1600. Now when you have a right to buy your asset or buy your share at 1500, you would definitely exercise. But normally you cannot go for physical delivery because you buying your own share would amount for your restrictions on buyback given under Companies Act. So that is why we are saying it should be net settled in cash for you to include it under the ambit of IND AS 109. So as financial asset. Now once we have expressed all this, let's look at situations now. Property, plant and equipment. My property, plant and equipment, if you observe, critically examine, guys, what you're going to get by using that property, plant and equipment, we will derive probable economic benefits. This need not be cash. Using my machinery, I produced a finished good. The economic benefit is measured in terms of finished good. So that means my economic benefits need not be cash. I'm deriving economic benefits which are other than cash, so they are excluded from IND AS 109. Similarly, if I'm looking at instruments without prepaid expenses, prepaid expenses, what will you receive from prepaid expenses? I'll receive goods or services. I'm not going to receive cash. I'm either getting goods or services. It is not the cash portion which I'm getting. So that means they are also excluded from the scope of IND AS 109. Perpetual debt instrument. You're holding a debt instrument of another entity and it is perpetual. What is perpetual? No right to receive. The principal portion. Because you normally get the principal portion at the time of liquidation or an uncertain future event happening, and it is a remote chance of occurrence. That's why we call it as perpetual. No right to receive principal, but you have a right to receive interest. I have a right to receive interest here. Since I have a right to receive interest, and this right to receive interest is in the form of cash, hence you can call that this is covered as per IND AS 109. It is a financial asset as per IND AS 109. So what are we trying to understand under financial assets? If you want to identify an item as a financial asset, you have to first determine whether you have a contractual right to receive cash or not. Cash and bank balances, balances with banks, balances in cash, all these are financial assets. Number two, contractual right to receive cash. Right to receive cash means trade receivables, deposits, staff advances, contractual right to receive cash. Or to receive another financial asset. So I have a right to receive an endorsement or a bill of exchange, that becomes it. Or an equity instrument of other entity, even that also is a part. I forgot to include that. Equity instrument of another entity. I hold shares in Infosys. It's a financial asset for me. I hold shares in X Limited. Financial instrument for me. I hold debentures of X Limited. Still a financial asset, because debenture, there's a contractual right to receive cash at the time of redemption. So that means it becomes a financial asset for me. Contractual right to exchange assets and liabilities, financial assets and financial liabilities, under conditions which are potentially favorable. That means as on today's date, they are favorable to the enterprise. It is unfavorable to some other enterprise. Favorable for you, asset for you. Unfavorable to you, liability for you. Contractual right to receive entity's own equity instruments. If it is net settled in cash, then we can call it as a financial asset. If it is settled by physical delivery, it is completely prohibited as per the application of the standard or application of this rule of buyback. This is what we can understand with the help of a word, financial asset. We have to look at what is a financial liability. How is it different from equity? What are the situations where we separate a financial liability with an equity instrument? Yes, guys. So let's continue to discuss about financial liabilities now. We have just discussed about financial assets. Let's look at what a financial liability includes. Very clearly, he says financial liability should be separated from equity. Then what is an equity instrument? What is a financial liability and what is an equity instrument? First, let's discuss about financial liability. I'll come back to your equity instruments once again. When I look at this word financial liability, I discuss about financial liability and we say that it is a contractual obligation. To deliver cash or another financial asset that means I'm obliged to pay cash. I'm talking about trade payables. I'm talking about loans. I have an obligation to pay cash to the banker. I have an obligation to pay cash to my creditors. I have an obligation to pay cash for my outstanding expenses. Now, or obligation to deliver another financial asset. That means, instead of delivery of cash, I'm settling it by exchange of some other financial asset. That means, let's say I'm settling it by exchange of issue of shares. Shares in my enterprise is basically a financial asset to another enterprise. So such are the contracts which I'm talking about. Or contracts for exchange of financial assets and financial liabilities under conditions potentially unfavorable to the enterprise. Contracts where we exchange financial assets and financial liabilities under conditions which are potentially unfavorable to the enterprise. That means I entered into a contract. I've entered into a contract, or let's say I've taken a loan from a banker. And as per the terms of the agreement, he said, if you do a default of 3 installments, you will have to pay a penalty of 10%. So what is happening? By the time I've actually defaulted the 3rd payment, it has automatically become a financial liability for the excess amount also, because it is unfavorable to the enterprise. If I have a derivative contract, let's say I have purchased a future to purchase the dollar at 75 rupees. But today the rate of dollar is only 70. So I have to compulsory pay 75 to acquire the dollar, where the market price is only 70. That means I'm paying extra. That means it is unfavorable to my enterprise. So I'll record it as a financial liability. The person who is other party to the contract will be selling the dollar at 75 when the market price is 70. It is favorable to him. He will classify it as a financial asset. Now, at the same time, contracts settled in entities own equity instruments contracts which are settled in entities own equity instruments number one derivative Number two, non-derivative. Now, derivative contracts or non-derivative contract. When I talk about these kind of contracts, which are derivatives or non-derivatives, understand, derivative always increases or decreases in value, while non-derivative contract is constant in value. When I'm looking at a derivative contract, he says that the derivative contract should be settled by a fixed number of shares or a non-derivative by settled by variable number of shares. Contracts which are settled in entity's own equity instruments. That means you are delivering equity shares of your own enterprise. And I'm saying if it will be a derivative contract, then it's a fixed number of share is a financial liability. Non-derivative contracts where we have an obligation to deliver variable number of shares, also it becomes a financial liability. What is an equity instrument then? Equity instrument is the one which evidences a residual interest in the enterprise. So I'm saying equity instrument, it evidences residual interest in an enterprise. It evidences residual interest in an enterprise. Residual means at the end, it is most subordinate. Subordinate to any other liability. Subordinate means lower in sequence of payments. Least in sequence of payment is an equity instrument. Now, along with that, equity instruments have something to deal with financial liability as well. We will see the relationship between financial liabilities and equity instrument when it is settled in entity's own equity instruments. We will talk about that in a short while, but let's talk about what these contracts are. I said, if there's a contractual obligation, to deliver cash, it's a contractual obligation to deliver cash, or another financial asset contractual obligation to deliver cash or another financial asset can be termed as financial liability. If there is no contractual obligation to deliver cash, then we will call it as equity instrument. Similarly, contracts settled by issue of entity's own equity instrument . If I am trying to settle the contract by issuing my own equity share, in such case, think whether it is a derivative contract or a non-derivative contract. If it's a derivative contract, that means it changes in value, settled by variable number of shares or settled by fixed number of shares. Same way, non-derivative contracts settled by issue of variable number of shares or fixed number of shares. When I look at situations like this, derivative contract always increases or decreases in value,
While non-derivative contract, the consideration of the contract is constant. There's no change in the value. Whether variable or fixed number of share, I'll always call it as a financial liability. Whenever a non-derivative contract is settled by variable number of shares, it'll again be called as financial liability itself. But a non-derivative contract's fixed, settled with fixed number of shares, is an equity instrument, and this is called as fixed for fixed test. This is called as fixed for fixed test. Now, this is certain test which we have to understand in classifying an instrument either as an equity instrument or a debt instrument. Let's talk about this. Let's deal with it and break it up into pieces and pieces. Contractual obligation to deliver cash. When do you get a contractual obligation to deliver cash? I have a deposit. I have a rental deposits which I have of my property which I have leased out. Such rental deposit has to be refunded back to the tenant as soon as he vacates the premises. Contractual obligation which I have undertaken to deliver cash upon a subsequent event. It becomes a financial liability for you. For example, if you are looking at outstanding expenses, salaries outstanding, rent outstanding, I have to deliver cash to settle the liability. Creditor for goods, creditor for fixed assets, creditor for expenses, I have to deliver cash to settle them. That is called as contractual obligations to deliver a cash or another financial asset becomes a financial liability for. We've already discussed about this potentially unfavorable to the enterprise and potentially favorable to the enterprise. Now I'm talking about contracts which are settled by issue of entity's own equity instrument. And I'm saying there is something called as fixed for fixed test. What is this fixed for fixed test? Means that if there's a fixed amount of consideration for which you're issuing fixed number of equity shares, then I will say that it is an equity instrument. If either the value of the contract changes, that is the consideration payable to the for the liability changes, or the number of equity shares issued changes, then in such cases, it will always be called as financial liability. It is not an equity instrument any further. This is what I'm talking about, a fixed for fixed test. So I'm saying, derivative contract changes in value, you settle it by variable number of equity shares or you settle it by fixed number of equity shares, I'll always call it as a financial liability. But non-derivative contract, it does not change the value. The consideration payable under the contract is fixed, but I am settling it by issuing variable number of equity shares. That means I said I will issue the shares according to the market price on the date of settlement. Let's say I'm issuing convertible debenture. Convertible debentures on a fixed date at a particular rate of the fair value on that date, I will issue equity shares. So it will be classified as a financial liability. Derivative contract settled by non-derivative contract settled by fixed number of equity share, we classify it as equity instrument. For example, a debenture is a non-derivative contract. There's no change in the value. Or a loan. Loan taken from a banker and there's a contingent consideration there saying that if there's a default in the value of a loan, it gets converted into 10,000 equity shares. Did the loan value change? No, it's a non-derivative contract. How did you settle it? With the issue of fixed number of equity shares. You know exactly what number of equity shares that you're going to issue for converting this loan into equity, for settling this liability of loan. Such cases, we apply something called as fixed for fixed test and we classify them as equity instrument. There are certain exceptions or couple of exceptions for classifying a particular item as a financial liability. What exactly are these exceptions? And we'll have to deal with each exception in depth. Let's see, first of all, what a fixed for fixed test means. Then we will talk about the exceptions for classifying a financial liability. Yes, guys, so we were talking about fixed for fixed test. What is this fixed for fixed test? We use this fixed for fixed test when we want to determine the difference between a financial liability and an equity instrument. When you have contracts which are settled by issue of entity's own equity shares, so we are here saying that to determine whether it is a financial liability or an equity instrument, we use this concept of fixed for fixed test to determine the difference between an equity instrument and a financial liability. Let's see how this fixed for fixed test really applies. When we talk about consideration in the contract, number of shares to be issued and their classification. Let's see how we determine in this case. How many cases are possible here? Here, if you observe, the cases possible are where the consideration is fixed, number of shares are variable. Or when the consideration is variable and the number of shares is fixed. Or when the consideration is variable and the number of shares is also variable. And finally, fixed consideration, fixed number of equity shares. Here we are saying everything will be classified as financial liability except in the case where we have fixed for fixed. This place it becomes an equity instrument. So I'm saying basically whenever we have a classification of financial liability and equity instrument, we'll use something called as fixed for fixed test. And this is how we apply a fixed for fixed test. Now, what do you mean by when we say that the consideration is variable? When do you say that a consideration is variable? I'll say that the consideration is variable in situations where it is a derivative instrument. It is a derivative instrument. Then we have variable consideration. That means the consideration payable under the contract keeps on increasing and decreasing. Now fixed means it is a non-derivative contract. It's a non-derivative contract which does not change its value. Now this is what we are talking about when we talk about fixed for fixed test in determining the difference between financial liability and an equity instrument. Let's see now the exceptions from financial liability. Exceptions from classification as financial liability. Certain instruments by nature should not be classified as financial liabilities. What are these instruments which should not be classified as financial liabilities, and why is it that we should not be classifying such instruments as financial liabilities? The exceptions to this basically are classified into two types. Number one, the first type of classification where we are not going to classify it as financial liability exceptions is number one, liabilities which are payable only on liquidation. Why is it that it cannot be considered as a financial liability? Because for you to call it as a financial liability, it should have a fixed and determinable payment. Now, where is this fixed and determinable payment? That means I have a particular creditor whom I will be paying within 30 days. I have a particular loan which is for a period of 5 years. Fixed and determinable. Here, only on the event of liquidation. That means it is uncertain. Because in any enterprise, we normally assume something called as going concern. When you assume a going concern in an entity, the liquidation or the event of liquidation when it occurs is very uncertain. So that amount which is payable at the time of liquidation will always be considered as a financial, is not considered as financial liability. You call it as equity instruments. For example, irredeemable preference shares. They are equity instruments. They cannot be classified as financial liabilities. Now, the second one is puttable financial instruments. Puttable means they are repayable in cash, but they have specific nature when you call them as puttable financial instruments. What are these puttable financial instruments and why are they excluded from being classified as financial liability? Now, for us to explain what a puttable financial instrument is, we say that puttable financial instruments we call a financial instrument as puttable financial instrument if two conditions are satisfied. What are the two conditions which are necessary to be satisfied to call it as a puttable financial instrument? The first condition which is necessary to be satisfied to be called as puttable financial instrument is first one, holder of the instrument has a right to put back the instrument to the issuer on an uncertain future date. Uncertain future date, I have a right to put back. Now, what is this uncertain future date? I don't know when. But it will happen. Occurrence or non-occurrence of this instrument being having a right to put back or right to have redemption in cash is based on a particular incident or an event which is not certain to occur. For example, you can talk about situations where he said, I will make sure that the amount is repaid when the net profit of my organization reaches 23%. When is it going to reach? I don't know. When the revenue of my enterprise clocks 500 crores, I will redeem this instrument. I don't know when. So they are uncertain future events, have nothing to do with the organization control. Neither the holder can control that particular event. In such situation, we have a right to put back. Those instruments are called as puttable financial instruments or instruments put back to issuer at the event of liquidation. There's an obligation which will arise to pay, but a right to put back arises only at the time of liquidation of an enterprise. Only at the time of liquidation of the enterprise, the right to pay arises. In such situation, we call it as puttable financial instruments. Very similar to liabilities which are payable on liquidation. But here I'm saying the instrument will put back. That means that instrument need not be always a liability. It can be an instrument which can be other than called as a liability, like preference shares, which will be paid only at the time of liquidation. They'll automatically put back on the event, on an uncertain event. Even this is also uncertain because even I don't know when the liquidation really arises. These instruments are called as puttable financial instruments. to classify a particular instrument as a puttable financial instrument, there are certain conditions that the instrument should be satisfying. Then we can call it as puttable financial instruments. What are these conditions which are necessary to be satisfied? Let's see them.
Yes, guys. So we were talking about puttable financial instruments and we said these cannot be classified as financial liabilities. And we said the puttable financial instruments are not classified as financial liabilities. And there are two types of such puttable financial instruments or two conditions to be satisfied. We said either the holder has a right to put back to the issuer these instruments on an uncertain future date, or the instruments automatically put back to the issuer on the date of liquidation, which is also uncertain because normally we assume that an organization has a going concern. So what are the conditions to be satisfied to call it as a puttable financial instrument? Number one, the holder of instrument is subordinate to any other instrument. What does this word subordinate means? I already told you, this word subordinate means this instrument is in particular ranks last in repayment. This is number one. First condition to be satisfied to be called as a puttable financial instrument. Number two, the holder is entitled to receive pro rata net assets in the enterprise. Pro rata net assets means residual value. Out of residual value, he is entitled to receive pro rata amount. For example, let's say I have two classes of shares. Class A shares are general equity shares or normal equity shares, or you can call them as ordinary shares. While I have a class B share, and this class B share says that they will either receive the face value of the pro rata amount or 10 lakhs, whichever is lower. In such case, I have an additional condition for class B shares. Such cases, we cannot call them as a puttable financial instrument. There should be a pro rata. Pro rata means proportionate. Proportionate residual value in an enterprise, then you can call it as puttable financial instrument. All puttable financial instruments have similar characteristics. That means everyone is subordinate. No one has an edge over the other. Everyone is subordinate to any other instrument. All the pro rata instrument, all the puttable instruments will receive a pro rata amount of net assets. And the total cash flows will be affected by profit or loss in the enterprise. Why? Because as the entity keeps making losses, their reserves keep on getting negative. So their value of net assets will keep on reducing. So that's why we say total cash flows are affected by the amount of profit or loss in the enterprise.
profit is there, the amount that they will receive will increase. If there is a loss, it will automatically decrease. These are called as puttable financial instruments. Example, you can take it as equity in SPVs or mutual fund units which are redeemable on liquidation. These are called as puttable financial instruments. Now, when we have understood this puttable financial instruments, let's try to understand even further and get into the concept. And I said puttable financial instruments are excluded from the concept of something called as financial liability. Similar type of characteristics are even there for preference shares. Very similar characteristics are held even by the preference shares, because preference shares, the conditions of issue keep on changing. Let's see how it changes. Number one, you can have either a redeemable preference share or it is an irredeemable preference share. If I'm looking at the concept of redeemable preference share, either it is at the option of holder of the instrument or redemption at the option of issuer of the instrument, or sometimes could also be on maturity date. Whenever I am saying it is redeemable at the option of the holder or redeemable on maturity of, on a maturity date, you can call these as financial liabilities. But whenever you're talking about the option of the issuer or irredeemable shares, these are equity instruments. They're equity instrument and these are financial liabilities. If it is redeemable on a fixed maturity date or at the option of the holder, they are financial liabilities, because I have an obligation to pay. I have an obligation to pay whenever he asks me to do it. I have an obligation to pay whenever that day arrives. So such cases, there's a financial liability. I have an option to pay whenever I have sufficient cash. Is there a fixed maturity date? No. Irredeemable preference shares, I'll redeem them only on liquidation. Then such cases, we call it as equity instruments. Look at the concept of preference dividends now. My dividend concepts also will differ in identifying whether it is a financial liability or an equity. Non-cumulative dividend or cumulative preference shares. Whenever it is cumulative, again, we are saying it is as per the contract there is no contract obligation. I need not pay at the time of liquidation. I said I will accumulate it. I never said that I'll pay. I've issued a preference share like this. It is a 10% preference share which will be redeemed at the time of liquidation. The amount of preference dividend, if unpaid, will get accumulated. But if it cannot be paid, if the enterprise does not have sufficient cash resources to pay the payment, then the preference shares are only entitled to receive the face value of those preference shares. There's no contractual obligation for me to pay the amount of accumulated dividend. In these two situations, we call it as equity portion to the extent of dividend. If it is payable as per a contract, then I'll call it as
financial liability.
This is what we can understand with respect to preference shares.
I am saying if a preference share is redeemable or irredeemable,
and if the redemption is on a maturity date, fixed maturity date, or the due date is checked by the holder. The holder can redeem the preference shares at the end of 3 years whenever he wants. Now, after 3 years, whenever he wants the payment, he will request for it. It becomes a financial liability because you have a contractual obligation to pay. I will call back the preference share whenever I feel it is important for me. Whenever I have sufficient cash, option of the issuer, it becomes an equity instrument. Irredeemable preference shares, only redemption at the happens at the time of liquidation, equity instrument. Preference dividend, if it is non-cumulative, definitely equity. If it is cumulative and it is the contractual obligation to pay the amount of preference dividend, whatever is accumulated, it becomes a financial liability. If the amount is not payable as per the contractual obligation, becomes again an equity instrument itself.
This is my brief understanding on what we can talk about with respect to preference shares in classification as financial liability or an equity instrument, depends on circumstance and the issue, what terms, whatever have been agreed upon.
Yes, guys. So let's talk about a very peculiar kind of instruments, and these are called as compound financial instruments.
I'm naming them as compound.
Compound means they're hybrid instruments. What is hybrid? Hybrid means basically they have an equity and a liability portion which coexists. Now, what did we mean? I said a compound financial instrument is basically a hybrid instrument. It's a hybrid instrument in which an equity and a liability portion will coexist. Whenever you find such kind of instruments, we call them as compound financial instruments. Equity and a liability portion coexists in that instrument. Now, when do I call it as a compound financial instrument, and how do I determine these compound instruments? When I'm looking at this compound financial instruments, we are saying that I have a perpetual instrument. I have a perpetual instrument, but this perpetual instrument has a fixed return. Perpetual instrument means amount is payable only at the time of liquidation. Fixed return, compulsory payments each year. Or I have redeemable instruments which have a variable return. Or I have redeemable instruments with conversion option. That means at the option they can get converted into equity shares. These are certain examples which I can quote for something called as compound financial instruments, also called as hybrid instruments. Why do I call them as compound financial instruments? Because I said the liability as well as the equity portion coexists in that instrument. Perpetual instrument, payable only at the time of liquidation, we call these as equity instrument. Very clearly I said you cannot classify them as financial liability. Fixed rate of return. Fixed rate of return means again financial liability, because the amount payable is fixed and determinate. Fixed amount of outflow of cash. Redeemable instrument payable on redemption. Amount payable on redemption surely is a financial liability, but it has a variable return. Return is not fixed. They're entitled to a pro rata return, so normally we call them as equity instrument. Redeemable instrument, whenever I say redemption, it's a financial liability, but they have an option to convert, a conversion option. Such conversion option is equity instrument. This way we observe that such compound instruments will have an equity portion and a liability portion which will coexist in that instrument. Such instruments is what we know, what we normally know as compound financial instruments or hybrid instruments. Recognition of compound financial instruments. How do I recognize a compound financial instrument? For me to recognize a compound financial instrument, we need to observe something called as split accounting. I use the word for recognition purpose. We are applying something called as split accounting. What is the split accounting talking about? Split accounting means since they coexist, I will split them. That means such instrument, by virtue of your split accounting, has to get split into two types. What is the amount of liability component in it? And the amount of equity component on it. How do we identify this liability and equity component in a compound financial instrument? For me to determine an equity or a liability portion in a compound financial instrument, to determine these two, I'll use certain techniques. It is not possible for me to reliably measure the fair value of equity component. So first I will do a reliable measurement of liability component. Because liability has a fixed maturity and a fixed amount which is payable. Identify the fair value of liability. Or obligation to pay. What is the fair value of the obligation to make the payment? Equity instrument is nothing but residual value, that is fair value of compound instrument. Reduced by minus less fair value of liability. This will determine what is the fair value of equity portion. I am trying to determine first the fair value of liability, and I am saying out of the total value of the compound instrument, if I reduce the fair value of the compound fair value of liability, I get the balance is equity portion. How do I determine this? To determine the fair value, we have to identify the present value of future cash outflows payable as per the contract. It is a present value of future cash outflows which is payable as per the contract. What is your obligation to pay?
my obligation to pay we identify, and we do a split accounting by identifying the present value. To determine this present value, I need a discount rate. Discount rate here is called as effective interest rate. In this case, the effective interest rate is the rate at which similar instruments are issued without conversion option. A rate at which similar instruments have been issued without the equity component in it, such rate will be considered as effective rate of interest. Now this will sum up the entire concept regarding compound instrument. What did we say in compound instrument? We said that these are peculiar instruments which are of hybrid nature. Why do you call it as hybrid nature? Because there is an equity as well as a liability component which is coexisting in that instrument. What are we supposed to do? In that situation, we will do something called a split accounting. What is the split accounting meaning? Split accounting means I will separate the amount of liability from the equity portion. How do you separate liability and equity? First, identify the fair value of the liability. Equity will be the balance fair value of the instrument. How do I determine the fair value of the liability then? What is the present value of future cash flows payable as per the contract? That you discount it to the present value. And using an effective interest rate, that will be the present value or fair value of liability component. Equity component is fair value of the total compound instrument reduced by the amount of liability component. That will give me what is the equity component fair value. So we were discussing regarding the compound instruments. Let's see. Compound financial instruments, and we said these compound financial instruments, you have to make sure that there's separation between equity and the liability portion. So when we're discussing about this compound financial instrument, let me take a peculiar example to explain what exactly I'm talking about. Let's say I have a 10% convertible debentures. My 10% convertible debentures have a value of 1 lakh. They carry 10% rate of return. Then I'm saying redemption by conversion after 5 years. EIR, my effective interest rate, is nothing but rate of interest on debentures without conversion option is equal to, let's say, 12%. With this given information, I want to identify what is the amount of liability and equity portion in this contract. To identify the liability and equity portion in this contract, let's say first I'll identify liability. How do you identify liability? Liability is nothing but fair value of future cash flows. What is fair value of future cash flows? Nothing but the present value. What is the future cash flow? Just check. For year 1 to 5, my cash flow is 10,000. Why? Because my total liability portion is 1 lakh, 10% rate of return, 5 years I'll get cash flow of 10,000. At the end of year 5, I'll have to completely pay 1 lakh. Since it is cumulative, I'll apply PVF. One single time, I'll apply PVF. What present value factor? I'll apply it at effective interest rate 12.5. Accumulative effect of these two is called as fair value of liability. Now, you people can calculate, guys, but one thing I can tell you, this is definitely less than 1 lakh. By no chance it can be more than 1 lakh, always less than 1 lakh. And then I am saying the equity portion is the residual value. Is residual value of compound financial instrument. How do I calculate residual value of compound financial instrument? My residual value of compound financial instrument here would be the total value of compound financial instrument being 1 lakh minus the value of liability. If your liability would have been 80,000, your equity portion would have been 20,000. Depends on what is the discount rate and how you calculate the value. But this in essence will give you an understanding of how to determine the amount for a compound financial instrument and how to apply a split accounting to determine the value of liability and equity component. Yes guys, so let's discuss about the miscellaneous concepts before we end this concept of equity and liability discussion. Recognition of interest which I pay on financial liability, or the amount of dividends which I pay on equity instrument, or gain or loss on subsequent recognition. I'm talking about recognition of interest or dividend being paid, interest paid on financial liabilities, dividend paid on equity instruments, or gain or loss on subsequent recognition. How do I recognize these items in my financial statements? Now, to recognize these items in financial statements, we will first divide them. Prima facie thing is divide it. On financial liabilities, whatever you get as interest or dividend payments, because sometimes there can be dividend payment due to preference shares which are classified as financial liability, or on equity instrument, equity share, irredeemable preference shares, irredeemable preference shares at the option of the issuer, all these are equity instruments. On a financial liability, we will recognize in P&L. On equity instrument, we recognize in statement of changes in other equity. That means adjustment should happen through reserves. Recognize in statement of changes in other equity for equity instruments. For a liability, recognize in the amount of P&L. So this is the first thing that we understand when we're talking about recognition of interest or dividend on subsequent or on subsequent recognition of financial liabilities or equity instrument. We'll also have to look at reclassification. The first type of reclassification is my reclassification from financial liability. It was a financial liability before, or was classified as financial liability before, but now it tends to be an equity instrument. The change of the issue terms are such that it has become an equity instrument. It is no longer a financial liability. Number two, it was an equity instrument before, but it has now got classified as financial liability. Two possible reclassifications in this case. Let's see under each one how we recognize the amounts. Now, if I'm talking about reclassification from financial liability to equity component, in such case, it is always measured at carrying value. It is measured at carrying value on date of reclassification. Since it is measured at carrying value, there is no gain or loss which arises at the time of reclassification because you are seriously measuring it at carrying value itself. So no gain or loss arises on reclassification. But when an equity instrument converts into a financial liability, then it has to be measured at fair value. When on fair value? Fair value determined on the date of reclassification. Reclassified at fair value when an equity instrument converts into a financial liability. Here, there is a gain or loss which arises. Gain or loss does arise in this case of reclassification because earlier you were recognizing it as equity, now you are recognizing it as financial liability. Such gain or loss on reclassification will be recognized in other equity. So we are saying reclassification is possible. Financial liability can become equity instrument, equity instrument can become a financial liability, but we are saying if your financial liability becomes an equity instrument, then measure it at carrying value on the date of reclassification. If an equity instrument becomes a financial liability subsequently due to change in terms, in such situation, measure it at fair value on the date of reclassification. Since you have measured it at fair value on the date of reclassification, there could be some gain or loss which will arise on reclassification. Such gain or loss I will recognize in statement of other equity, that is statement of changes in equity. So this is regarding reclassification. This is regarding interest, dividend, gain or loss on subsequent recognition of financial instruments. Yes guys, so let's continue and talk about a very important concept where we discussed starting about IND-AS 109. We've been discussing about 32 so far and we said 32 deals with your definitions and identification of equity or financial liability. Now with the introduction of IND-AS 109, I will have to start looking at classification of financial assets and liabilities. I'll also have to look at measurement of these items. I'll also have to look at the recognition and derecognition. Before closing it down with impairment and finally hedge accounting. These are the significant aspects which are discussed as per IND-AS 109. I've started with classification, went into the measurement, then the recognition and derecognition, impairment, hedge accounting, and that will end the scope of the standard. Let's start first with classification. We'll go into measurement at a later point of time. First, let I'm talking about classification. I will start with classification of financial assets. I'm trying to classify my financial assets, and what are the different ways in which I classify my financial asset?
To classify the financial assets, we apply two different methods on both on a combination basis. To classify the financial assets, I'll undertake two tests. One is an instrument level test.
What is the instrument that you hold and what are the conditions attached to that instrument? Along with an entity level test on what is the intention and objective of the entity.
What is the structure of the instrument?
What is the objective of the entity? Both combined will define what is my classification of a financial asset.
Now, first, when we are looking at instrument level, at the instrument level, what we have to look at here is
something called as CCF or SPPI test. CCF stands for contractual cash flow test, and SPPI stands for solely for payment of principal or interest. Entity level, we call it as BM test. That is a short form, normally know it as business model. It is normally known as business model test.
So these are the two tests which are predominantly applying to classify a financial asset. First, let us look at the CCF test or SPPI test.
Contractual cash flows. This is CCF. Derived from instrument are solely from payment of principal and interest. SPPI, solely for payment of principal and interest.
This is called as contractual cash flow test. Now, whenever I'm looking at a contractual cash flow test, here I'm saying we will apply this test to understand what is the contractual cash flows arising from the instrument. If the contractual cash flow arising from the instrument are significantly or solely due to a reason of payment of principal and interest, if your answer is yes to this, then I'll call it as a debt instrument. However, if your answer is no to this, then we will apply it as equity instrument or a derivative instrument. So I'm identifying two things. If it satisfies the SPPI test or CCF test, it is a debt instrument. If it does not satisfy the test, I'll either call it as an equity instrument or a derivative instrument. CCF, contractual cash flow. For example, if I am holding a debenture of a company which is redeemable, my contractual cash flows arising from that instrument, either in the form of debenture interest or the principal amount being repaid at the time of redemption, such instruments satisfy the CCF test. For example, staff loan given. I've given loan to staff for a festive, or I'm giving a loan to the car staff to buy a vehicle. So what is happening? I'm collecting a concessional rate of interest on these loans,
But ultimately, even that instrument of staff loan is deriving cash flows in the form of interest and principal. It is solely in the form of interest and principal, such transactions you normally know as CCF test. They are called as debt instrument if they have satisfied the test. In a very similar manner, if I look at, if I'm looking at transactions which are related to retention money, I have done a particular contract or executed a particular contract, and the customer is telling me that he will release 10% of the total amount only at the end of something called as defect liability period. Very normal, guys. These words are very common. Defect liability means at the end of the contract, he will say that 6 months, whatever damages occur, I will compensate. So the customer is saying, "Theek, anyways, you said you will compensate. So I will not release a 10% of payment until you satisfy your obligation." Now this 6 months, I'm holding that amount of, retention money. Now it becomes a receivable for the contractor. It becomes a financial asset for the contractor because he has a right to receive cash in that obligation. Now when I have a right to receive cash, am I getting anything other than amount of principal or interest? Absolutely no. Such kind of contracts, such kind of instruments, such kind of financial assets are called as debt instruments satisfying SPPI test. But sometimes you have units of mutual fund. You have investment in equity shares of a company. Now these type of instruments, you do not get any contractual cash flows. It is very undeterminable or not practical to explain what is the amount of cash flow that will be generated and when will the cash flow be generated. I have shares in a particular company and in the current year he has given me a dividend of 20%. Is it possible for me to confidently say that there is a contractual obligation to the company to pay 20% dividend even in the next year? Absolutely no. The company is not doing well. They have not been performing well. So in such cases, you cannot apply this principle because he's clearly put it down in conditions saying that it should be satisfying something called as contractual cash flows in the form of principal and interest only. Equity instrument, principal will be paid only at the time of liquidation. That's why we call it as equity instruments. Such is the classification done as per CCF test. Let's try to understand the second one. The second part is also very interesting understanding for business model. This predominantly considers the objective of enterprise. To derive economic benefits from the instrument. In how many ways can I derive economic benefits from the instrument? I can derive economic benefits from the instrument solely in the form of principal plus interest, or in the form of sale to others, or in the form of combination of both. I want to derive contractual cash flows from payment of principal and interest, also derive economic benefits from sale of the instrument, or I want to do a combination of both. In such situation, you call it as business model test. It is called as business model test. So it is my objective to derive economic benefits. How are you deriving economic benefits? In the form of payment of principal or interest, or economic benefits derived from sale, or economic benefits derived on a combination of both. This is basically known as a business model test, or the intention of the enterprise to derive economic benefits to an enterprise. Now, I said I have to apply both the conditions together to establish the classification of financial assets. The categories of classification go like this. My categories of classification can be explained in three parts. The first one being called as amortized cost. In short, we call it as AC, or you can call it as fair value through OCI. In short, we call it as FET OCI, or a fair value through P&L, and in short, we call it as FVTPL. Amortized cost, fair value through OCI, fair value through P&L. This is my classification criteria, or this is the category by into which I can classify, and this classification should be based on both instrument level test plus entity level testing. How do we apply in classifying an item as amortized cost or fair value through P&L or your fair value through OCI? How do we identify this amortized cost, FETPL and FETOCI? This we'll have to understand one by one, step by steps in this approach, but the classification should only be as per these three criteria. That's it. Clear? So to sum up, I'm saying that to classify a financial asset under amortized cost or fair value through P&L or fair value through OCI, every instrument by the held by the entity should pass through two tests. One is called as instrument level test, called as CCFC test or SPPA test. Contractual cash flows arising from the instrument solely from the payment of principal and interest. Then if this test is satisfied, we call them as debt instrument. If the CCF test or SPPA test is not satisfied, we call them as equity or derivative instruments. Once the instrument level testing is done, then apply the entity level testing. What is the intention of the enterprise? What is the objective of the enterprise? The objective of the enterprise is to derive benefits from sale of asset. The objective of enterprise is to hold the asset till maturity and derive benefits from payment of principal and interest. The enterprise has an intention to hold it for a particular period and then derive economic benefits from sale. Combination of both. Now, in applying this and allocating them and categorizing them under each head of amortized cost or FETPL or FETOCI, what are the things to be considered? Let's break it down and understand in parts. Yes, guys. So like we were talking about the classification of financial assets, let's understand how do we classify these assets. We were looking at three things, starting with something called as amortized cost. For you to classify a financial asset as amortized cost, first of all, you have to put them through two tests. What are the two tests which we are talking about? One is instrument level test. Other one is entity level test. Remember, I call this as CCF or SPPI test. This one I call it as business model or BM test. Contractual cash flows or solely for payment of principal and interest test and business model test. Now, if by chance, if you say that under an instrument level test, such an asset, financial asset, happens to be a debt instrument. It happens to be a debt instrument as per an instrument level test. It can be classified as amortized cost, provided I have conditions to be satisfied.
A debt instrument can be classified as an amortized cost financial asset if the enterprise objective is to derive cash flows solely from payment of principal and interest. If the enterprise objective is to derive cash flow solely from principal and interest, then you call a debt instrument as amortized cost. Then let's look at the next one. Under instrument level test, let's say it was an equity instrument. If it was an equity instrument, it can never be classified as amortized cost. So amortized cost can only include debt instrument, such instrument which an enterprise has an objective to hold to derive cash flow solely from payment of principal and interest. Now, this is regarding amortized cost for debt and equity. We have also seen something called as derivative instrument, which I will introduce towards the end. I'm not going to talk about it now. Next one, FVTOCI, fair value through other comprehensive income. It can include a debt instrument. Only if, here you said the objective is to derive cash flows only from principal and interest. Here I am saying the objective to derive cash flow from payment of principal or interest also subsequently from sale. Here there's no sale condition. Here I'm saying only to derive principal and interest. Derive cash flow from subsequent sale of the asset. Then you can call such instruments as a debt instrument, which will be classified as FVTOCI. Equity. If I'm looking at equity instruments, which should be classified as FVTOCI, then I can say that it is an equity instrument which is classified as FVTOCI only if, number one, it is specifically designated as fair value through other comprehensive income. And number two, it is not held for trading. An equity instrument which is not held for trading and it is specifically designated as FVTOCI, then the condition here is separated by and. That means both the conditions are necessary to be satisfied to classify an equity instrument as FVTOCI. Now, that is regarding FVTOCI. Let's look at the third classification which I am talking about. This is regarding the third classification of financial assets as something called as FVTPL, fair value through P&L. When do I classify an instrument as fair value through P&L? If under instrument level test, it is a debt instrument. If it was a debt instrument,
to be classified as FVTPL, then the conditions which are necessary to be satisfied are, number one, when it is not classified as AC or FVTOCI, you cannot classify it as amortized cost or FVTOCI, then you can classify it as FVTPL. Or that means second condition, they are irrevocably, designated as FVTPL at the time of inception itself, at the time of beginning of the contract itself. They were irrevocably designated. That means the enterprise had an intention to present these as fair value through P&L. In such situation, you can do it. Or it was a debt instrument which could neither be classified as amortized cost nor be classified as equity or FVTOCI. Then if I'm looking at equity instruments, an equity instrument can be classified as FVTPL. When is that going to happen? Number one, it is held for trading. We have used this word twice. Under FVTOCI, we said it is not held for trading. Under FVTPL, I'm saying it is held only for the purpose of trading. And it is not specifically designated as FVTOCI. That means an equity instrument, if it is designated as FVTOCI, should be considered as FVTOCI. If it is not considered as FVTOCI, then you have to consider it as equity instrument. Observe, equity can never be amortized cost, so should lie between FVTPL and FVTOCI. If an enterprise intends to present the fair value through OCI, then it becomes FVTOCI. If it is not interpreting or if it is not designating it as FVTOCI, you consider it as FVTPL. The last one we have to understand is derivatives, which I haven't discussed so far. Whenever you are looking at a derivative instrument, always it is FVTPL. It is always FVTPL if I am looking at derivative instruments. So this in specific sense is how I classify the financial assets as amortized cost or FVTOCI or FVTPL. This is regarding amortized cost. Under amortized cost, we continue to say that basically, if it is a debt instrument and you are holding such debt instrument principally to receive the amount of cash flows only from principal and interest, such instruments are called as amortized cost. Equity instrument can never be amortized cost. FVTOCI, we are saying it could either be a debt instrument which is classified as FVTOCI, or it is an equity instrument which can be classified as FVTOCI. A debt instrument which is held with the purpose of deriving cash flows from principal, interest, also along with subsequent sale, if it is, then it is FVTOCI. Equity instrument which is not held for trading and you have principally designated, you have specifically designated that instrument to be recognized as FVTOCI, in such cases you can classify the financial asset under FVTOCI. Under FVTPL could be a debt instrument which could neither be classified as amortized cost nor be classified as a FVTOCI, then such cases you have to use FVTPL. Along with that, you can also irrevocably designate a debt instrument as FVTPL only. While you're looking at equity instrument, it is held for the purpose of trading. Now, what is this held for the purpose of trading? We will come and we'll look at the logic. When can you say that something is held for the purpose of trade? It is held for the purpose of trading, has not been irrevocably designated as FVTOCI, then you can designate that equity instrument as FVTPL. Derivative instrument not discussed under amortized cost, not discussed under FVTOCI, only discussed under FVTPL, and we said always it should be considered as a debt of FVTPL instrument. This is my classification criteria, what should be satisfied to classify a financial asset under either amortized cost or FVTPL or FVTOCI. Let's try to summarize everything, put it in a much better format where we can actually refer at one single glance and tell us how the classification really happens. Let's see that now. Yes guys, so we were talking about the classification, let's put it up this way, but I said before that we will discuss about something called as what is this held for trade. When do you call that a financial instrument is held for the purpose of trading? You can call a financial instrument to be held for the purpose of trading if an enterprise intends to dispose that financial asset in near future. Your purpose of acquisition itself is to dispose it of in near future and derive economic benefit from that. Number one. Number two, where you have actually acquired an asset which should be classified to that part of portfolio which has recently underseen a short-term profit taking. You have recently done a profit, short-term profit taking in that part of the portfolio and you have acquired such financial asset which is classified to the part of portfolio, then you can call it as held for trading. Third one is called as derivative instruments. So number one, it can be held for trading if the enterprise has acquired acquires a financial asset with an intention to dispose in near future. You have purchased it with an intention to dispose the amount in near future, then you can call it as held for the purpose of trading. Similarly, I'm talking about the second one, second condition. I said financial asset is classified to that part of portfolio which has recently evidenced a short-term profit taking. Short-term profit taking. And last one, it is a derivative instrument. Derivative instruments are also held for the purpose of trading. I have acquired the financial asset primarily with an intention to dispose it of in near future. Let's say, for example, I purchased a few dollars with an intention that I expected that the value of a dollar to appreciate or the rupee to depreciate in near future. So my expectation could be for 3 years or three months or 4 months. So when I said near future, this word near future, you can construct it and say that it is less than or equal to 12 months. Anything less than or equal to 12 months can be considered as near future. Let's say you have acquired certain mutual funds which you recently have actually sold it off in short term.
Recently, you have sold a set of mutual funds in short term. Now he's saying, sir, I want to basically acquire another mutual fund. You are acquiring a financial asset which will be classified to that part of portfolio which has recently you have evidenced a short term profit taking in that. Such financial assets are held for trading. Third one is derivative instruments. So you can say that derivative instruments are futures, options, forwards, swaps, interest rate swaps, etc. Multiple commodities are there which you can trade as derivative instruments. Now this is held for trading, and I said anything which is held for trading should always be classified as FVTPL. It cannot be classified as FETOCI. So equity instruments held for trading should always be classified as FETPL, cannot be designated as FETOCI. Now once we have seen this, let's try to understand then what is this classification. So I'm saying for the purpose of classification, how do we actually pictographically at one glance, how do we get it? Classification of financial assets. For the purpose of classification of financial assets, I would say that I'll first put them through instrument level test. At instrument level test, I'll apply either a contractual cash flow testing, CCF, or SPPI test solely for payment of principal and interest test. I'll apply either of these tests to basically determine whether an instrument is basically an equity instrument or a debt instrument. Either it is a debt instrument or it is an equity instrument. Or it can be a derivative instrument. These are the three classifications that we get from an instrument level testing. Once you have done the instrument level testing, now look at the debt instrument first. I have to put it through BM test, business model test. As per business model test, I said solely for the purpose of principal plus interest, my purpose of holding this financial instrument is only for the purpose of receiving benefits in the form of principal and interest. Our second one, purpose of principal plus interest and also subsequent sale. Also, I'm saying it is held for subsequent sale. Number three, or you're saying it is other than these purposes. You're holding for other than these purposes, then what is the classification? If I'm holding an asset or a financial asset solely for the purpose of principal and interest, and it is a debt instrument as per SPPI test, I'll classify this as amortized cost. If it is a debt instrument as per SPPI test, and as per my business model, I want to derive
principal interest also from subsequent sale of the asset. In such case, if it is FET OCI, I don't know how what purpose I'm holding it for. I'm neither holding it for principal or interest, neither holding it for principal interest or subsequent sale. In such cases, I'll classify it as FETPL. Under equity instrument, first check if it is held for trading. Or you also have to check whether it is designated as FETOCI. Trying to put up and say that if an equity instrument is held for trading and your answer is yes, then I'll always classify it as FETPL. If it is not held for the purpose of trading, then look at designation as FETOCI. If it is designated as FETOCI, then it should be classified as FETOCI. If it is not designated as FETOCI, then it should be classified as FETPL. Remember, derivative instrument always FETPL. There is no condition at all. Always it is. It is always FETPL. A debt instrument per se, if I am looking at a debt instrument and I am saying that a debt instrument can be irrevocably, it can be irrevocably designated you can irrevocably designate it as FETPL. It can be irrevocably designated as FETPL. This is a summary of what we have just discussed regarding classification of a financial asset, either as amortized cost or as FETPL or as FETOCI. This is a brief understanding, guys. So at one glance, I can get the entire classification of financial instruments in one glance. So definitely help you in picking up the classification whenever a question really comes up from here. Yes, guys. So we have seen classification. Now let's look at measurement of financial assets. Measurement of financial assets. How do we measure the financial assets and what is the treatment for initial and subsequent measurements? For discussing about the measurement, I'll have to look at all things starting from amortized cost, as well as those which are classified as FETOCI, as well as those which are classified as FETPL. All three classifications have to be understood now. Let's take it one by one. Now when I'm calling about the classifications out here, I'll first begin with initial recognition. Initial recognition of a transaction or regarding a financial asset which is classified as amortized cost or FETOCI or FETPL. Initial recognition, if it is happening as per amortized cost, always measure it at fair value. Whatever is the classification, always measure every transaction of financial asset at fair value. Now, when is this initial recognition happening? Initial recognition is at the time of acquisition. When you first acquired your asset, that is the date on which you first recognize a financial asset, and always the recognition should be at fair value. Then we look at subsequently. My subsequent recognition of financial asset should happen at the time of measurement at balance sheet date. On balance sheet date. On the date of balance sheet, when you're measuring a transaction or financial asset at amortized cost, always measure it at amortized cost using EIR. What is EIR? EIR is a term which I've already used in Ind AS 23, which is called as effective interest rate. We will see the computation of effective interest rate as per Ind AS 109, but this we have already discussed earlier as a part of Ind AS 23. So I'm saying it should be measured on each balance sheet date at amortized cost using something called as EIR. FET OCI and FET PL, by the name itself it indicates, they should always be measured at fair value. Always measured at fair value on each balance sheet date. Now on subsequent recognitions, you normally find that there is a gain or loss which arises. Gain or loss on subsequent recognition. On subsequent recognition, whatever gain or loss arises, especially when I'm talking about transactions related to amortized cost financial assets, always to be charged to P&L. Not just your gain or loss on subsequent recognition, there is also some other thing which will arise periodically. I call this as periodic returns. My periodic returns on financial assets are either in the form of interest or in the form of dividends. Either you can receive interest or dividend from your financial assets. Be it interest or dividend, always make sure that you are recognizing in P&L in whatever case it might be. Just a second, guys. I think I made a mistake. This one is not P&L. When you're looking at FET OCI, always recognize the gain or loss in OCI. The gain or loss on subsequent recognition, by the name itself, it says fair value through other comprehensive income. So measure everything at fair value and make sure that the changes are captured in your other comprehensive income. So I first discussed about initial recognition. Then we came down to subsequent recognition. Then we talk about gain or loss. Then I am talking about periodic returns. This is what we have discussed about so far. But I am not really comfortable with hearing this word amortized cost using effective interest rate until unless I know what exactly this effective interest rate is. When I use the word effective interest rate, how do I calculate this effective interest rate? Now this word, we have already used it as a part of Ind AS 23 when we are talking about borrowing cost. We did discuss about borrowing cost and where we were talking about exactly what an effective interest rate comes up to when we are discussing about borrowing cost. Similar transaction regarding effective interest rate we'll have to discuss now. But normally to talk about in an initial recognition, you are saying fair value, fair value, fair value. Every time using the word fair value, I'm not really comfortable with. If you observe, this is the only place where significantly I use something different other than fair value. When I said fair value, fair value, fair value at initial recognition, how do I initially recognize the fair value? I've entered into transaction using a particular transaction price. What makes you believe or say that your transaction price is not equal to fair value. Normally, I would say that the transaction price at which you entered the transaction, at the time of acquisition of the financial asset, whatever is your cost of acquisition, whatever is the transaction price that you're paying, that should be equal to the fair value. What if it is not so? You have entered into a transaction in such a way that the transaction price is not equal to the fair value. Maybe your buyer and seller are related. The seller with whom you are transacting today is a related party. So it has influenced the price slightly. The seller is not actually in a position to transact. He is forced to enter into the transaction. Then the transaction price cannot be equal to the fair value. When I said forced to transact, don't always go into a situation where you're pointing a gun at the seller and saying that you have to sell the asset. Not necessary. There's a compulsory acquisition which happens. Now this compulsory acquisition, whenever it happens, the seller is not interested to transact. But due to public interest, he has to hand over his property at a particular price to the government. Such price which he's paying to the government pays him, is not a transaction price, is not equal to the fair value there. So there are events where we understand that the fair value might not be equal to the transaction price. Then in such situation, when there is a difference between the transaction price and fair value, I will still recognize the transaction only at fair value in each situation. Then how do I deal with the difference? How is the difference being dealt with in your financial statements? Now let's understand that. So yes guys, so we were talking about transaction price, and I said transaction price normally, in a general situation, normally I'm talking about in a transaction when I say normally your transaction price is equal to fair value. Transaction price, the price at which you entered into the transaction to acquire that financial asset, should normally be equal to fair value. This is a genuine normally situation. But I am saying there can always be situations which crop up to say that the fair value might not be the transaction price. If I'm putting an if condition saying that the transaction price is not equal to the fair value. Buyer and seller are related. Seller was forced to transact. All these situations you come across and you say that there's an amount of difference, or there's an amount of difference between the transaction price and the fair value. In this situation where I'm talking about the fair value is not equal to the transaction price, I would continue to say that recognize the financial asset at fair value on date of transaction. On date of transaction, always recognize the asset at its fair value. There's no questions raised regarding that. But my problem is the difference. My problem is with respect to the difference, what should I do? The difference between transaction price and fair value. The difference which arises between transaction price and fair value, how do I treat such difference in your financial statements? Whenever it comes to treating such difference of financial statements, I would say that you have determined the fair value as per level 1 input. For fair value, if you have determined the fair value as per level 1 input, then simply charge to P&L. No further discussion, simply charge to P&L if you have determined the fair value as per level 1 input. If your fair value is determined as per level 2 or level 3 inputs, we have discussed about this level 1, level 2 and level 3 inputs. In such case, either you can charge to P&L, one option that I can give you, or instead you can capitalize to cost of asset. That means you can add to the cost of financial asset that you have transacted. What was the level one input? Market observable factors have been considered. No significant or insignificant unobservable data has been considered in computation of fair value. This terminology which I am using now here is not as per Ind AS 109. I am using this terminology as per Ind AS 113. I have observed I have taken into consideration the market observable inputs in determining the fair value, then it is a level one input. If I have considered market observable inputs along with an inconsiderate or immaterial unobservable inputs, then I will say that it is level two. Significant in unobservable data, if you have used, then I'll call it as level three inputs. This we have discussed as a part of 113. I don't want to repeat it all over again. Now, this is a difference which arises whenever your transaction price and fair value are significantly different. Now, I am also talking about something called as EIR, abbreviated form of effective interest rates. How do I calculate this effective interest rate? Whenever you are looking at effective interest rate, it should consider the interest carried on financial asset adjusted by, what should be the adjustment which should form part of computation of EIR? Now, your adjustments in computation of EIR split into two types. What I should consider, what I should not consider. Adjust in EIR. Ignore in EIR. What should I consider? What should I ignore in computation of effective interest rates? Whenever I am calculating effective interest rate, my adjustment of EIR should be to the extent of originating fee. Originating fee, that means once the loan has arisen, a little bit of fees is collected. If the loan is expected to arise, and number two, ancillary charges incidental to borrowing. You can give certain examples of processing cost, legal fees, stamp duty, normally you pay stamp duty, legal fees at the time of registering a mortgage. So all these, whenever you take a borrowing, you have to register a mortgage. Such processing charge will be considered. Ignore the originating fee. I will ignore the originating fee if the loan is uncertain to arise. I'm not sure whether I'll get the loan or not. When you're not sure that you're going to get the loan or not, no effective interest rate adjustment, straightforward charge it off to P&L. debt syndication cost. Lump sum charges which are collected for arrangement of debt. Sometimes chartered accountants themselves collect this debt syndication fee as a consultancy charges for arrangement of debt. These are called as debt syndication fee. They are normally excluded in computation of EIR. Now, theoretically, it sounds good in computation of EIR, but my question is, practically, how do we do it? In taking an example with the numbers, we will try to determine what exactly is your effective interest rate. Yes, guys, so when do you classify a financial asset? At the time of originating the asset. That means at the time of inception, at the time of acquisition. What if there's a change in the business model? Your business model initially was to recognize or to derive the benefits in the form of principal and interest. Now, due to conditions of liquidity, you have changed it and you said that, sorry, right now I don't want to hold it for principal and interest, but I want to derive the benefits from sale of the asset. In such cases, how do I deal with the instrument? This is called as reclassification. This is called as reclassification. Reclassification of financial assets. When we're talking about this reclassification of financial assets, we will have to understand how these financial assets are reclassified and when are they reclassified. When are they reclassified? I already told you, normally reclassification happens when there is a change in the business model. When there is a change in business model. In such events, what is this reclassification which really happens? How do I deal with this reclassification? Remember, guys, so when we're talking about this, we'll have to look at initially classified as FVTPL, FVTOCI, or amortized cost. Subsequently classified as FVTPL, FVTOCI, and amortized cost. Initially and subsequently, you have measured it like classified it this way. How do I deal with this situation now? Initially recognized as FVTPL, subsequently recognized as FVTPL cannot arise. Because it's already FVTPL, what are you going to reclassify again? This is not possible. Same way, FVTOCI to FVTOCI is not possible. Amortized cost to amortized cost is not possible. Now I will have to look at what exactly am I talking about here and what is this reclassification which happens and how do I reclassify it? FVTPL, I can classify as FVTOCI should be taken at fair value. But whenever you're reclassified as amortized cost, then you have to measure it at amortized cost using EIR. FVTOCI transferred to FVTPL, again recognized at fair value. And amortized cost always recognized at amortized cost using effective interest rate. Amortized cost transferred to FVTPL should always be at fair value. Or even to FVTOCI should be at fair value itself. Now remember, guys, what I'm talking about now. I'm marking this part. And I'm saying, if you have subsequently reclassified and measured it at fair value, then I'm saying the difference between the carrying value minus the fair value on reclassification should be equal to zero, or they are transferred to P&L or OCI. When is it zero? When you have reclassified it to from fair value through P&L to fair value through OCI, or fair value through OCI to fair value of P&L, then you will find that the change in the fair values are zero, because they have always been measured at fair value, but now you are again showing it. But this part, amortized cost transferred at fair value should be transferred to FVTPL, then your difference should be transferred to P&L. If it was amortized cost reclassified at OCI, difference should be transferred to OCI between the carrying value and the fair value on recognition. This part, amortized cost using effective interest rate. In this situation, he says, compute the amortized cost from the beginning of the instrument when the instrument was first recognized. From that date you calculate the amortized cost. You are not supposed to calculate from the date of reclassification, but you have to start computation from the date on which the amount, the transaction was first recognized. Now, this is something that we are talking about with respect to reclassification. So I said reclassification is possible within all the three headings. When you are measured already at fair value, either FVTPL or FVTOCI, and again reclassified unto FVTOCI or FVTPL, these four categories I'm talking about, then the change in fair value will become zero. Amortized cost being transferred to fair value to OCI or fair value through P&L because of change in business model test should be transferred to either P&L or OCI. If it was reclassified as FVTPL, I'll transfer to P&L. If it is reclassified as FVTOCI, I'll transfer it to OCI. Whenever you have reclassified FVTPL or FVTOCI as amortized cost, then such amortized cost should be computed from the beginning on the date on which that transaction was first recognized. Clear? So this is the concept regarding reclassification of financial assets. This concept will make you clear about reclassification of financial assets. I will end it with a small point. Whenever FVTOCI becomes FVTPL, reclassification of FVTOCI to FVTPL, whenever this situation arises, on the occurrence of such kind of events where your FVTOCI becomes FVTPL, then all the accumulated changes in fair value where did you earlier recognize? Earlier recognized in OCI because it was earlier FVTOCI. Should be reclassified to P&L.
all the changes in fair value, which you earlier took it to OCI, now upon reclassification should be transferred to P&L from OCI. This is one significant sentence that you have to remember at the time of reclassification. Guys, if you actually this standard has undergone a change in 2010, there was earlier something called as tainting rule. This word tainting rule is no longer applicable today. It was there earlier, but it is no longer applicable today. There's something called as tainting rule. You don't have to understand that because it is not there under Ind AS 109 before. But earlier, regarding reclassification, we had something called as tainting rule which was applicable.
Yes, guys. So since we have already discussed about financial assets, let's start discussing about classification of financial liabilities. Classification of financial liabilities. We have seen the identification of financial liabilities. Now let's observe what is a classification for financial liability. Now when you talk about classification of financial liability, it's explained in a very simple manner than what you compared to when we were talking about financial assets. Because when we talk about financial liabilities, in simpler sense, you put it across in this way. A financial liability can be classified based on my intention to settle the financial liability. If such liabilities are held for sale or held for trading or they are irrevocably designated, in both these situations, whether they are held for trading or they are irrevocably designated, in such situation we classify them as something called as FVTPL. Either they are held for trading or they are irrevocably designated, then I will classify them as fair value through P&L. In any other situation other than these, then I'll classify them as amortized cost. This is my classification for financial liability. Whenever we are trying to classify our financial liabilities, there are only two classifications, unlike we had three classifications with respect to financial assets. Here we are only classifying them as financial FVTPL or amortized cost. That's it. FVTPL or amortized cost. If they are held for trading, we have seen the definition of what is held for trading under financial assets. Same definition for held for trading will apply even to the financial liability. And we are saying they are irrevocably designated as FVTPL. In these two situations, we'll classify them as FVTPL. Otherwise, we normally call it as amortized cost. Held for trading, my purpose to hold them for trade. Irrevocably designated, that means you can never change it. When we discuss about these things, you need to understand that there is no reclassification at all. There is no chance that you reclassify for financial liability. No case of reclassification of financial liabilities. Now, in the same way, when we look at the recognition, the measurement of these concepts, they peculiarly undertake a very similar measurement concepts which are already discussed as per your financial assets. Measurement under FVTPL or under amortized cost. Let
Like you remember when we said,
at the time of initial recognition, how do we measure the transaction? At the time of subsequent measurement on each balance sheet date, how do we take it? My initial measurement should always happen at the time of transaction, and my subsequent measurement should always happen on each balance sheet date. Subsequent measurement on balance sheet date.
It undergoes a similar process of financial assets. Always, at the time of initial recognition, always measure them at fair value. No change in this. Subsequent measurement, whenever we are looking at FVTPL, should be measured at fair value. When we look at amortized cost, the name itself suggests that we are recognizing or measuring it at amortized cost using effective interest rates, EIR. And whenever the situation arises, on subsequent recognition, there is a change. A gain or loss on subsequent recognition arises. A gain or loss on subsequent recognition. My gain or loss on subsequent recognition, when we are looking at FVTPL classification, then it clearly is saying fair value through P&L. So that means a change in fair value should always be transferred to P&L. Even in the case of amortized cost, we will transfer them to P&L only. This is very similar to what we have already seen under financial assets. There is no significant difference with the measurement. But the only thing which we are saying is there is no third classification. And number two, there is no reclassification of financial assets. Sorry, for reclassification of financial liabilities. So this will, in a sense, discuss about how a financial liability should be dealt with and what is a measurement scales which should be preferred whenever it is talking about financial liabilities. Now, if this is a financial liability, this will basically end our concepts regarding recognition and measurement, except for impairment of trade receivables. Now, impairment of financial assets is a very critical concept to understand because we apply something called as probability of default. Let's see what it actually talks about. That is the last concept regarding measurement of a financial asset or financial liability. Once we are done with this, we'll have to significantly move into something called as recognition criteria. Yes, guys. So the last part of measurement where we start discussing about something called as impairment. Now, whenever I say impairment, I'm associating to assets only. Impairment of liabilities will be contradiction to the conservatism concept. So only impairment of financial assets. Now, impairment of assets, we have a separate standard to deal with, that is IND AS 36. Then why again here? Because under IND AS 36, we have clearly excluded from the ambit of impairment something called as financial assets. Financial assets are excluded from the ambit there. So we have included it specifically to discuss only about financial assets under IND AS 109 itself. Now, impairment is basically indicating towards loss in value. This we have also discussed as a part of IND AS 36. Nothing new which is coming out now. Loss in the value of a financial asset. Now, this identification of loss in value is based on something called as probability of default. Approach. We normally call it as POD, PODs. Now, what is this POD or probability of default approach? When we indicate a probability of default approach, I am asking the probability of default to the management. Management should make sure that they're making an unbiased assessment.
an unbiased assessment by management. So management will come out with an unbiased assessment of what could probably be the amount of default that would be measured in a transaction relating to trade receivables. So I'm looking at probability of default based on unbiased assessment by the management to decide upon what is something called as impairment. How do I define this probability of default and how is the impairment being measured upon? To define impairment on measurement, we will define your financial assets into two types. I will divide my financial asset into two types to determine my impairment on financial assets. One, I will talk about trade receivables. Other one, I will be talking about other financial assets. No particular classification, I'm just calling them as other financial assets. That's it. Trade receivables and other financial assets. These are the two predominant classifications based on which we define impairment on financial assets. How we define under trade receivables? For trade receivables, my probability of default for measuring your impairment depends on lifetime expected credit loss of the company. Lifetime expected credit loss in an enterprise. Now, lifetime expected credit loss, lifetime, that means throughout the life of the enterprise, what was the credit loss that you have observed in the company? Now, when I'm talking about lifetime expected credit losses, I am not going to define one ad hoc figure or one cumulative figure for the entire thing. Here, we have to be very specific about the customer, the product, market, specific approach. It should be specific to the customer. This customer, how well he has been doing business with me. I find that over the period of time, there is no bad debt from this particular set of customers. So there is no probability of default that can be estimated over the lifetime of the enterprise to determine the impairment on your trade receivables. Now, over a particular product, this particular product, we have been consistently finding 5% of default on credit customers. So that is a probability of default placed per class of products being circulated. Market, whenever I'm doing a transaction in a particular market, let's say the market belonging to India or anything outside India. Outside India, there's no probability of default. Everything has been taken through an LC. So there is nothing called as a bad debt which arises there. But Indian enterprises, I find about 8% of bad debts over the lifetime of the enterprise. But however, when I'm looking at other financial assets, we will have to see whether there is a significant increase in credit risk or no. Significant increase in credit risk. When you're looking at this significant increase in credit risk, if there is an increase in the credit risk significantly, then we will again adopt a lifetime expected credit loss. If there is a significant increase in credit risk, if your answer is yes, I'll again adopt lifetime expected credit losses for the enterprise. If I don't find any significant increase in credit risk, then you don't have to do such a big exercise to identify what is the amount of bad debt to the enterprise. Lifetime expected. Imagine I have been consistently trading volumes with a particular customer and this customer has been there in my organization since last 10 years. Lifetime expected. That means over last 10 years, what is the amount of bad debt I have to calculate on that particular customer, and I have to do an exercise to identify what is the probability of default. But
when there is no significant increase in credit risk, why do you want to go and do an elaborate calculations altogether? That's why he said, you don't have to do elaborate calculation. Identify 12 months expected credit loss. Lifetime expected credit loss, 12 months expected credit loss. Now the question arises, first of all, what is this significant increase in credit risk? What do you mean by credit loss? How do I calculate the credit loss? Definitely I have to discuss about. I am saying that a significant increase in credit risk, to define this, when I want to discuss about the significant increase in credit risk, we are saying that it is by nature. You will say that there is an assumption given in the standard. Assumed as greater than 30 days overdue. Anything which is 30 days overdue, you can call it a significant increase in credit risk. You can say that there is a significant increase in credit risk if it is overdue beyond 30 days. Overdue, I'm talking about this term, overdue out here. How do you say something is overdue? How do you know it? I've sold goods today. I haven't received the payment since last 30 days. Can I call it as overdue? Absolutely no. You have to look at the credit terms. I've sold it on 30 day credit. That means the amount falls due only after 30 days from the date of transaction. Now when the amount is falling due only 30 days after the date of transaction, how can you say that just because you did not receive the payment for the first 30 days, the amount is falling overdue? It is just due after 30 days. Any one single day which is beyond the date when it falls due, you call it as overdue. So within the due date he had to pay. If he could not pay within the due date, then every single day after it falls due is called as overdue. Now, so that means anything beyond 30 days overdue, I will say that there is a significant increase in credit risk. Now, let's undergo further and let's discuss even further into this concepts. Very interesting concepts which are going to be coming up now is, what is this credit loss? Credit loss is not bad debt. I'll put it like this. When I say credit loss, I am not indicating towards bad debts by any chance. Very good then. Now what is your credit loss then? In this concept, when you're saying, fine man, credit loss is basically not equal to your bad debts. So bad debt is a different assessment. Credit loss is a different assessment. So impairment based on credit losses is completely different. What do you mean by this credit loss then? The meaning of credit loss means, if an amount falls due on 30th of April, when the actual receipt of payment was done only on 15th of May, I'm saying the due date is on 30th of April, but actually the amount was received on 15th of May. That means I got 15 days after the amount was due. From the date on which the amount was due, the amount was received. Now guys, 15 days beyond the time when which you are receiving the amount, in such cases when I'm talking about this 15 days, for 15 days there is a loss in the value of your credit. This 15 days, we'll call it as credit loss. I should have received the amount today, but I've received after 15 days, we call it as credit loss. This credit loss is basically the loss in time value of money. Now, credit loss means it is not that it was the payment was not received. It means that basically you could not collect the payment on due date, and since it was extended beyond the due date, I have lost time value of money. Had the money been received 15 days before, that 100 rupees which I received 15 days before is much higher in value than the 100 rupees which is received 15 days later on. Now, that is what is called as credit loss. For me to identify ECL, that is your expected credit loss, to calculate, I'll say trade receivables or any other receivable, financial asset value, multiplied by POD, probability of default, multiplied by time value of money. ECL calculations are quite critical to an enterprise, guys. Quite critical to an enterprise, because your expected credit loss computed on any receivable should be a multiplication of the receivable amount multiplied with the probability of default, POD, that we have already discussed about, management estimate, multiplied by time value of money. This time value of money is given by effective interest rate. Yes, guys. So we are saying, identify the receivable where there's a credit loss. How do you identify? See if it is a trade receivable. If it is a trade receivable, then go as per lifetime expected credit losses. What is lifetime expected credit loss? Over the life of a particular customer or a particular market or a particular product, what was the credit loss which the enterprise has experienced in the past? How did I experience the credit loss? What was the delay in payments that I was getting? Determine that amount. That will be probability of default multiplied by time value of money. Time value of money is an effective interest rate computation which we have already seen. Multiplication of this will give us what is expected credit losses, which should be assessed at the end of each accounting period. Compulsory should be done at the end of each accounting period. End of each accounting period. This is my expected credit loss strategy of how I recognize an impairment on financial assets. And I'm saying, if it is other than trade receivable, any other financial asset, then don't go as per lifetime expected credit losses unless and until there is a significant increase in credit risk. If there is no significant increase in credit risk, you don't have to track down the lifetime expected credit losses, but see the last year. Last 12 months expected credit loss, you find out that is sufficient for you to recognize the amount of expected credit loss on receivables or financial assets other than trade receivables. Yes, guys, since we have already significantly discussed on topics relating to recognition and measurement, we are supposed to talk about recognition and derecognition now. We have talked about classification and measurement earlier. Now we are discussing about something called as recognition and derecognition. First, I'll start with recognition of financial instruments. My recognition of financial instruments, I have two ways of accounting for it. My recognition can happen either on trade date or can happen on a settlement date. I have two ways of recognizing a financial instrument. I said, either you can go as per trade date accounting, or you can adopt settlement date accounting. When I'm looking at these two parts, like trade date accounting and settlement date accounting, what we need to exercise is settlement date is normally in a market situation on today's date. If I'm talking about the stock markets, which are regulated by SEBI in a recognized stock exchange,
It happens to be T plus 2 is the settlement date. Any trade date plus 2 days is considered to be the settlement date of transaction. Now, whenever I'm looking at trade date accounting or settlement date accounting, trade date means it is recognized on the date of transaction. While I'm looking at a settlement date, I'm saying this amount will be recognized on the date of settlement of transaction. How is it different and how does it change my accounting or recognition criteria? Let's say, for example, to discuss about these two concepts, let's say we have purchased shares in X Limited at 25 rupee per share. I acquired it on, let's say, 25th of April 2018. I've acquired it on 25th of April 2018, and this transaction was settled on, so T plus 2, I'll take it as 27th of April 2018. On this day, when the market price per share was 26 rupees per share. If I'm talking about this kind of situation, how does a trade date and settlement date accounting differ? If I do a trade date accounting, if I apply a trade date accounting, then my recognition happens something like this. I'll record it on 25th of April, the date on which I entered into the transaction. I'll record it as investment in X Limited account debit. To bank. How much did I pay? 25. And on 27th of April, I'm going to record the transaction for the gain of 1 rupee in the value. So I'll write, my investment should always be measured at fair value. Investments in X Limited account debit, 1 rupee. 2. The fair value change, such fair value change either recognized in P&L or in OCI based on the classification. Either they can be classified as fair value through P&L or they can be classified as fair value through OCI. Whatever it is, depending on that, the fair value change will go into the P&L. If I am looking at settlement date accounting, if I look at settlement date accounting, then the accounting transaction will be slightly different from what we have just passed the entries for. On 25th of April, the day when he has entered into a transaction, I will not record any entry. My entry will directly be recorded on 27th of April when the transaction is settled. In such case, I will record the entry like this. Investment in X Limited account debit. The value per share is 26 today. To bank, I paid 25. To fair value change, the fair value change is about 1 rupee. Now, this way, the entire transaction, as far as the recording is concerned, is significantly different for both trade date as well as settlement date accounting. So when I'm applying a trade date or settlement date accounting, the amount of gain or loss will be same. This amount of gain or loss which I recognized either in P&L or OCI will be exactly similar, but the only thing is the way that the investment or the asset is being recorded, this value will change on the date of recording. Now, this is called as trade date and settlement date accounting. This does not create much of an impact because it is happening within the same financial year, and that too, since I'm taking T plus 2 days, it's a very simple transaction accounting that happened. But had I applied the same situation of trade date and settlement date into derivative reporting, then it will slightly be changing, or they'll have a significant impact on how the value should be recognized. Let's see with respect to forwards and futures, how such transactions are normally recognized. Yes guys, so discussing further into trade date and settlement date accounting, I told you it will make a lot of difference when I'm talking about forwards and future contracts. Any derivative contract which normally has a settlement date much later, then you'll have a significant impact on this. Let's see what I'm talking about here. I'm looking at trade date versus settlement date accounting. And I'm counting on futures to determine this. Any derivative contracts when I'm looking at derivative contracts to enter into a transaction, now what significant differences do we observe? Now whenever I enter into a significant transactions regarding trade date and settlement date for derivative contracts, you need to observe that they are settled at a future date. Let's say my date of transaction, I have entered into a transaction on 1st of March 2018 to buy the shares of Mr. X Investments in X Limited, acquired on that market price date, spot rate being 25 rupees per share, being the spot rate, and at the same time I'm saying that the settlement date would arise on 21st of April 2018, and the market price per share on 31st March 2018 as at the balance sheet date end was about 26 per share, or make it 28 per share would make more sense, and on 21st of April, that is your settlement date, came up to about 26 rupees per share. And in this case, I'm saying the lot size for derivatives, always they're transacted in lots. Lot size is 100 shares. If I want to record this particular transaction as per trade date and settlement date, let's see how I do it. Trade date reporting and my settlement date reporting. I'm recognizing transactions on two significant dates, trade date and settlement date. Look at the situation now, how many days on which the transactions has really occurred? I can look at 3 days on which transactions have really occurred. Now transaction dates here, I would put them as 1st March 2008. Then I have to record transactions on 31st March 2008. I also have to record my transactions on 21st of April 2008. 3 dates for which the transactions would be recorded. Let's see how the transactions are normally recorded for both trade date as well as settlement date accounting. If I'm looking at trade date accounting, I'm going to record the transaction right on the day on which I enter into the transaction. On this day, 1st April, I have entered into a transaction to receive shares of X Limited at a price of 25 rupees per share, lot size being 100. So I will receive 100 shares at 25 rupees per share, 2500, and I have to remit that amount. So I have two things now. Investment in forward, or you can normally call it as forward asset, account debit to forward liability, and this will be recorded to the extent of 100 rupees, sorry, 100 into 25. But on settlement date, I'm not going to record any such transaction, not recorded by any chance. But at the same time, if I'm looking at 31st March, there should be a mark to market MTM. That means I have to mark it to the market price, that is 26. There's an increase in the value by 1 rupee. So here I'll record forward asset account debit. 1 rupee on 100 shares, so 100 rupee to P&L or OCI. This entry will be same even under settlement date account. At least the amount should be recorded under the same thing even for settlement date when you're marking it to market. But understand, guys, here I'm going to cancel this OCI since it is a derivative. Since it is a derivative, derivative instruments are always FVTPL, so always recorded only in your P&L account. Now, I'll go further and I'll explain the transaction on a settlement date, that is on 21st of April. So, irrespective of trade date or settlement date, the amount of 100 rupees as gain should be recorded compulsorily. If I'm recording on 21st of April, here I will record my forward asset and forward liability will be completely settled, and I have today, I'm sorry, 23, right? So 28, right? 3 rupees per share, 300. So on settlement date, now look at the transaction, how it completely varies. Now, I would say this also was a variation. I agree upon this. But now I see what is a real variation which comes on settlement date. I'm going to record the transaction as investment in X Limited account debit. Value of the shares is 2600 on today's date, but you have recorded the investment forward asset value at 2800, so there is a loss. P&L account debit 200. I'm supposed to cancel the amount of liability to be paid, so first I'll cancel the asset to forward asset 2800. Obligation should be settled, so my forward liability should be paid. My liability should be settled in cash or bank. What I'm gonna pay is only 2500. Liability was never restated. Now look at the settlement date accounting. Now straightforward, I'll record investment in X Limited account debit 2600 on today's date. P&L account debit 200 because there's a loss after recognizing your gain already here. I've already recorded a forward asset. I'll derecognize that, which was recorded to the extent of 300. To bank, I'm gonna settle the transaction by payment of 2500. This is the difference when I look at a trade date and a settlement date recording when we are looking at derivative contracts. Significant difference normally arises when you're recording the transaction on trade date and settlement date when we're talking about derivative instruments. Such difference could not be identified when we're talking about real contracts or spot contracts, but derivative contracts, future settlements, always create a huge impact whether you're accounting as per trade dates or settlement dates. Yes, guys. So since we have seen the recognition of trade date or settlement date, now let's understand, other than trade date and settlement date, which is for recognition, we will have to understand something regarding derecognition as well now. Now, recognition wise, I never said there's a difference between a financial liability or a financial asset. But for derecognizing a financial asset or a financial liability, you have different recognition criteria for financial assets, financial liabilities as well. Let's see what different types of recognition criteria are being derecognition criteria are put across. Now, when we are looking at derecognition, the first thing about derecognition that I have to understand is derecognition of financial assets and derecognition of financial liabilities. When I look at derecognition of financial assets and financial liabilities, under assets, again, I'm splitting them into two types. First, for debt instruments also for equity instruments. We will talk about financial liabilities later on. Now first let me talk about financial assets first. Debt instruments. Debt means you have a right to receive cash. So derecognition will happen when the holder does not have a right to receive cash. His right to receive cash is extinguished. He no longer has a right to receive cash, does not have any right to receive cash, he will derecognize the debt instrument. Number two, the holder transferred right to receive cash along with plus significant risk and rewards. When do I say significant risk and rewards are transferred? I'd say that significant risk and rewards are transferred when the holder who has transferred the right to receive cash is no longer liable if the instrument is not honored by the other party. If it is not honored, he should not be liable for that party. I will stress more on this when we talk about some conditions regarding bills discounted. Very important concept regarding bills discounted. Because of this concept, significant risk and rewards. Obligation with third party in such a way that cash flows arising from financial asset are transferred to settle the financial liability. Whatever cash flows you get from this financial asset, you have entered into an obligation to deliver it to someone else. Thus, such transactions also go derecognition, provided risk and rewards are transferred along with it. Significant risk and rewards are also transferred along with it. This is my derecognition criteria for debt instruments. Now look at equity instrument and how do I derecognize an equity instrument? For me to derecognize an equity instrument in this situation, we will have to see where he has transferred the equity instrument. Derecognition when the equity instrument is transferred. You have transferred the equity instrument. Or in a situation where the holder is not entitled. The holder is not entitled to receive benefit even on liquidation. If you are only going to receive on liquidation, you called it as equity instrument, you don't even have a right to receive anything even at the time of liquidation. Such cases, you'll have to derecognize a financial asset which is an equity instrument. Now, if I look at financial liabilities, when does this financial liabilities get derecognized? Now, observe the financial assets first. Under financial assets, we are clearly saying that the debt instrument should be derecognized when the holder no longer has a right to receive cash flow. I have already collected the cash flow. There is no further cash flows which are going to arise from that instrument. Or I have extinguished the right to receive the cash flow. There I will say that the instrument should be derecognized. Number two, I have transferred the instrument. I have given it to someone else. I have given the instrument. I have sold the debenture. I have given the bill receivable to my banker. And I'm saying, I'm not just giving you this instrument. I'm also transferring the risk and rewards which are attached to that instrument. That means I'm saying, I'm giving you this instrument. Along with that, I'm also saying that I'm transferring the risk and rewards which are attached to this instrument. That means if in future, the person who has written the instrument is not going to deliver the cash, I am not liable for it. So that is when you say, significant risk and rewards are also transferred along with the instrument. Third one is interesting one. I've gone into an agreement with someone and I said, boss, whatever I receive from this particular financial asset, my obligation is to deliver it to you. I've entered into an obligation with you to deliver whatever benefit or whatever cash flow that arises from this particular financial asset. Then in such cases, I will derecognize the debt instrument. These are my conditions to derecognize my debt instruments which are held as financial assets. When I'm looking at equity instruments for derecognition, when the instrument of equity is transferred or the holder has no longer a right to receive cash even at the time of liquidation of the company. Why did it happen so? Company got liquidated when the company itself is gone. Or the company's shares got substituted with some other company. So my previous company shares which got merged into the other company, there's no other obligation even at the time of liquidation. Because instead of giving you cash, I've given you a substitute, another equity instrument. So you cannot say that there is any cash flow which is arising at the time of liquidation. So the entire story is over. That financial instrument has to be derecognized or an asset has to be derecognized. Financial liability should be derecognized when there is no longer any obligation to deliver cash. There is no longer any obligation to deliver cash. Also, I'm saying that financial liability will be derecognized when the instrument is transferred. But along with the transfer of instrument, I'm also transferring significant risk and rewards. Similar cases of what we have seen as a part of debt instruments under financial asset. Very similar to what we have seen under debt instrument of financial asset, financial liability also gets derecognized
when he no longer has an obligation to deliver cash, my obligation is over. Or I have transferred the instrument along with significant risk and rewards. Now the instrument is not mine. I don't no longer have any obligation to pay anyone. So that way we'll say that we derecognize my financial assets and financial liabilities. Significant concept, guys, but I told you this transfer of significant risk and rewards has something to do with bills discounted, and which has come in as a new ITFG, very, very important and very logical in compliance to the standard. Yes, guys, so we will discuss about two very interesting ITFGs which I have to attach to your derecognition. Attaching to your derecognition, these ITFGs which I'm talking about is the first one regarding bills discounted with the banker. Bills discounted with bank. Under bills discounted with bank, there are two types of discounting. One is without recourse. One is with recourse. What is a without recourse and with recourse type of bills discounting? When I'm talking about with recourse or without recourse, the simple understanding that you have to get from this is simply because in a bills discounted, ultimately, if the asset or if the person who has written the bill, the person who has accepted the bill is not paying the amount in case of default, the liability falls on the holder who has discounted the bill. Such is called as with recourse. When I'm saying bills discounted with recourse, that means I'm indicating towards the holder has a liability even after discounting the bill in case of default. In case of default, holder is liable to the bank. When a bill is discounted with recourse, the holder is still liable to the bank only in the case of default. In such cases, I am saying financial asset is the amount recoverable from customer, and the financial liability is the obligation payable to bank. Obligation payable to bank. Under these two circumstances, I can tell you that I will not derecognize the financial asset and financial liability. I'm going to show both of them together. And this will get derecognized only when customer honors the bill. And not at the time of discounting. So at the time when you have discounted the bill is no longer yours. The bill now belongs to the banker. But still, I will still recognize a financial asset and financial liability. The reason why I have done this is because my risk and rewards.
are not transferred to bank. I did not transfer my risk and rewards to bank. That is the reason why I will still recognize the financial asset and the financial liability in such cases where the bill is discounted with recourse. However, when I have discounted the bill without recourse, in such cases, I can say that the risk and reward is transferred. Risk and rewards are transferred, hence you can derecognize the asset that is nothing but the bill when it is discounted. As soon as you discount the bill, you can derecognize the asset since you do not hold any further risk and rewards. This is predominantly what we have to discuss as a part of bills discounted with the bank with recourse or without recourse. A very, very interesting concept because this is peculiar in nature. Now, along with this, we also have one more significant ITFG. Before we go to that, I want to pick up a small concept regarding offset. Offsetting my financial assets and liabilities. What are the conditions which are necessary to be satisfied for offsetting financial assets and liabilities? This offset of financial assets and liabilities is significantly discussed again as per Ind AS 32. It is not as per 109. Conditions which are necessary to be satisfied for me to offset the financial asset and liability. The condition necessary to be satisfied to offset your financial asset and liability can be significantly said as: number one, it is legally permissible to set off. To offset. And number two, the enterprise intends to settle financial asset and financial liability on net basis. Let's say, for example, I have entered into a contract with the government to provide employment to certain employees, and the government said, I will make sure that certain amount will be reimbursed to you for payment of salary. You have agreed about that. On 31st March, the amount of salary was slightly outstanding to the extent of last 1 month. So you recorded one financial liability as outstanding salaries and wages to the extent of that 1 month salary. But you also recognized a financial asset because your government has clearly underwritten a contract to reimburse you for the salary paid to such employees. So what is happening? I'm recording a financial asset receivable from the government. I'm recording a financial liability payable to the employees. Is it legally permissible to set off? That is the first question. If it is legally permissible, what is your intention to settle? Sir, immediately, as soon as I receive the money from the government, I'll remit it to the employees. This has been my policy all the time. So in such situation, it is possible for you to offset the financial asset and financial liability. This will end our concept regarding offsetting financial assets and liability, which is the last component of Ind AS 32. So in Ind AS 32, we discussed about the definition, difference between financial liability and equity, and finally regarding the offset. If you remember, while I was talking about Ind AS 109, I was talking about classification, measurement,
recognition, derecognition. Every concept has been completed except for one small ITFG regarding your CDR, corporate debt restructuring. Let's discuss about that.